Hello, I'm Court Lindahl. Welcome to this examination of the talismanic architecture of Thomas Jefferson. From our earlier studies, we know that Thomas Jefferson may have become aware of the talismanic value and directional attributes of buildings while a student at William & Mary and being exposed to the secrets of the powder magazine there. We'll examine three structures designed by Thomas Jefferson and a fourth built by Robert E. Lee in the tradition that Thomas Jefferson had set forth earlier. Let's begin our examination by having a look at Monticello. Thomas Jefferson built octagonal elements into these structures that seem to denote important directions on the globe, creating what may be termed ley lines. Thomas Jefferson was a land surveyor, and he used these skills to become an architect also. And he learned how to do this at the College of William & Mary, where the powder magazine is located. So let's have a look at some of the directions that Monticello indicates with its octagon. First of all, to the northeast, it seems to point close to Barbersville Mansion. This is another Thomas Jefferson design structure that we'll discuss later that also includes an octagon. It also comes very close to Montpelier, the estate of James Madison. As this transect or arc on the globe reaches across the globe to Scotland, it transects just a few hundred yards north of Rosslyn Chapel. And we know Rosslyn Chapel is a famous place with many myths and theories about the strange stonework included in Rosslyn Chapel and what it means to masonry and the Knights Templar and possibly the Knights of Malta as well. Next, we'll see another veneration and connection with Thomas Jefferson as the line continues, now trending somewhat to the southeast. It transects the North Atlantic or the English Channel and reaches the Sanssouci Palace of Frederick the Great. Now we know that Thomas Jefferson had a great working relationship with Alexander von Humboldt, and here at the Humboldt estate right near Sanssouci we see the bas-relief from the Tower of the Winds in Athens. And indeed this entire tradition links back and harkens back to the Tower of the Winds. We also see the axis design at Sanssouci pointing back to Monticello. All right, let's examine what is to the southwest in the direction suggested by the octagon of Monticello. We will see the line transect the central counties of Virginia and come very close to Jefferson's other structure, Poplar Forest. Now, Poplar Forest is also another structure we'll take a look at here in a little while and give a sample of the places that it points to. It is also an octagon, likely built in the tradition of the Tower of the Winds, the octagons of Constantine the Great, the Tower of the Winds reproductions in England, the Newport Tower and the Powder Magazine and more. So we see this transect or arc on the globe coming from Monticello, coming within less than a mile of Poplar Forest, Thomas Jefferson's country estate. Now, further to the southwest, we see this transect or arc on the globe coming just 6 miles to the south of the famous Georgia Guidestones. And we've had lots of researchers and analysts suggest that the messages on the Georgia Guidestones are indeed, quote, Jeffersonian, or has his rational view of the world, and really the plaque there at the Guidestones does even say that this is a more rational view and we should take into account what the Guidestones are telling us. And this creates lots of controversy with groups of people who believe that there is an elite trying to eliminate X amount of the world's population. just saw an additional octagonal structure of Thomas Jefferson is Poplar Forest, and given what we've seen at Monticello, it should be obvious that Poplar Forest probably also points to some very pertinent places, including Mount Shasta, which will be discussed in my upcoming book. But here we'll see an interesting connection to what Thomas Jefferson did with Monticello. And it is possible that his intention even was to have Poplar Forest and Monticello point at each other, though this was not precisely achieved. And we see this line suggested by Poplar Forest, somewhat mimicking the line we just examined coming from Monticello, and it transects to Monticello just a few hundred yards to the northwest, and also the environment of Charlottesville and the University of Virginia, which is also designed by Thomas Jefferson. And there it transects very close to Barbersville Mansion and James Madison's Montpelier again, as many of the lines we'll examine in this video will show. And this line also extends to Scotland, but to a different place, to another large landscaped octagon at Stirling Castle, known as the King's Knot. And we've discussed the King's Knot before. It points to the octagon of the Tower of the Winds at Shugborough Hall, as well as the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem, and also a monument at Stirling known as the Jerusalem Stone. And these may be the kind of subtle metaphorical clues that are being given to us in this kind of activity. So Poplar Forest may be showing us a lot about Thomas Jefferson's possibly Scottish heritage or allegiances in many things he did. So here we are at Barbersville Mansion, designed by Thomas Jefferson and built at about the same time as Poplar Forest in 1822, and is similar to the design of Monticello with a central octagonal turret or tower there. And we'll see that Jefferson likely did orient this octagon on the globe to point to significant places as well. First, to the southwest, it points right through the middle of Charlottesville and very close to the Rotunda, Thomas Jefferson's copy of the Pantheon in Rome. And this building may also have a unique linear relationship with the Virginia State Capitol that he also had a hand in designing. But let's look to the northeast, and we see this arc on the globe suggested by the octagon at Barbersville, transecting the northern tip of the boundaries of Washington, D.C., or very close, and continuing up the East Coast, kind of in this alignment we've seen other researchers that examine, that includes Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York City, as all of these Jefferson structures seem to define. And we see this transect reaching Avebury, England, just less than a mile south of the circle itself and very close to Silbury Hill. It is possible that this was planned, that this was part of the reason that Jefferson aimed this octagon at Barbersville this direction, in order to achieve this spatial, linear, and angular association with Avebury. And backing this up is the next target. The same arc on the globe continues across Europe, where there may be other pertinent targets that we haven't found yet, but it transects directly to the ruins of Baalbek, Lebanon, and the hexagonal structure that is present there that was built as an imperial axis for Roman rulers prior to Constantine. So this is interesting. This is very similar to the way Sir Francis Dashwood's Tower of the Winds reproductions on his West Wickham estate near London points to Baalbek as well. And Dashwood also has a hexagonal mausoleum on his property that points to the Tower of the Winds. So all of this activity we're seeing Thomas Jefferson do may have been inspired by these English landed gentry who valued reproductions of the Tower of the Winds in the tradition of ancient Greece, and later Constantine the Great, who built several octagons, Emperor Nero, Emperor Trajan, who built the hexagonal port of Portus, that all had directional attributes to measure the globe with, to execute geodesy, or the measurement of the earth. So Barbersville Mansion, designed by Thomas Jefferson for his friend and governor of Virginia and U.S. Senator James Barber, right near Montpelier, James Madison's home, which is interesting because Madison seemed to have built his home. So if a line was generated by its orientation, it would point to Monticello. Now next, we have a structure built in veneration of Thomas Jefferson. The hexagonal Fort Carroll, built by Robert E. Lee while he was still part of the Federal Army of the United States. He built his structure, his hexagon, to point to the southwest and transect the center of the famous star in the streets of Washington, D.C. First of all, as this line continues, it comes about 100 feet north of his Arlington estate that he built, which is now Arlington National Cemetery after the Civil War. And we see the line will transect further to the southwest, to Monticello, to very close, just a few hundred yards north, just as the line from Poplar Forest came. And it also comes very close to Montpelier and Barbersville as well. We see a repeating theme of those three places being included in all of these alignments. So there we see it close to Monticello, but ultimately it comes to this newer memorial, the D-Day Memorial in Bedford, Virginia, placed there to commemorate the soldiers who passed at D-Day and the battle itself. And we'll see here momentarily the talismanic association that this memorial may have with other places on the line. So to the northeast, we're going to see Fort Carroll, the hexagon built by Robert E. Lee before he was a Confederate general, pointing to the northeast. And continuing and kind of again mimicking this famous line that people, alignment of cities, Washington, Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York City, and Boston, that all seem to have been intentionally aligned, or people theorize that this is true. A lot of other people have this pointing to Stonehenge, but we'll look and see where Robert E. Lee pointed his. Now, just as a coincidence or not, we have the D-Day Memorial pointed to, and we also have Normandy, the site of the Normandy D-Day invasion, being pointed to by Robert E. Lee's hexagon, very near the site of Omaha Beach, but really pointing to the site of the entire battle. Now, amazingly, this transect or arc on the globe continues on to Jerusalem and the Dome of the Rock. From a hexagon to an octagon, points on the globe. Robert E. Lee was an engineer and architect and would have had the skills to figure these kinds of problems out. So this is an amazing association. We see lots of European octagons or geomantic structures, Amiens Cathedral pointing to the Dome of the Rock, the Vatican Array pointing to the Dome of the Rock, and many more. So the Dome of the Rock, as we have been studying, possibly may be the burial site of Constantine the Great. And for more rationale on that, please see my next book, which will include all the background information about all of these places and all of the facts supporting what I'm saying here, that these structures were built to indicate directions on the globe. So that's all for now. As I say, stay tuned for my next book. And I have a documentary coming up about the mysteries of Northern California, where this activity was continued, indeed, by some of the same people who may have created the Rennes Chateau mystery, and even connections to Thomas Jefferson via John Bidwell, who created an axis in Chico, California. His brother was named Thomas Jefferson Bidwell. There seems to be a distinct respect and veneration of Thomas Jefferson by subsequent people who did this kind of activity by building geometric shapes of structures that pointed to other places on the globe. Thanks for joining me. I appreciate you joining me here to examine the ley lines of Thomas Jefferson and the talismanic architecture of our early American history. Thank you.